Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, dear brothers and sisters everywhere. We are back, inshallah, for the tafsir episodes, inshallah. And we finished last time, as you remember, the definition of Al Quran. So, inshallah, we'll go forward and continue. Al Basmala. When I say Al Basmala, I mean saying Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Al Isti'adha, saying A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajim. You know, when you start reciting the Quran, we say Isti'adha, then Basmala, then we start reciting and reading the Surah. Now, you could ask this question: is there any rule, any kind of ways how to say the Bismillah, and with all the surahs, not with all the surahs? Can I say it loud or secret? What is the direction here? To make it easy, Al-Bismillah, saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it's part of our recitation when you start reciting Al-Quran in the beginning of the surahs, except Surah At-Tawbah, as you know. So it's a bidayah. Bidayah means it's a title, it's a beginning for each surah, except Surah At-Tawbah and Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha, we have the title and we have also ayah number one. Ayah number one in Surah Al-Fatiha, also Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And it makes sense. It's the beginning and the opening of the book. So it makes sense to start that kind of book by saying, by the name of God, Almighty Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the Creator, the Most Merciful, the Most Kind. So we will go with that way. It's part of Surah Al-Fatiha. That's why when you look at the Mus'haf, they put number one after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, not before Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So always Al-Ayat has its own number at the end of the ayah. So when you count how many verses we have in Surah Al-Fatiha, you will see that we have 7 verses. So let's agree about that. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it's an ayah, not a bidayah. Bidayah means just a title. No, it's an ayah, it's a verse in Surah Al-Fatiha. Now, what is the ways of reciting Al-Basmala? Because we see some people, they say it silently, and others, they say it loud. You can pick whatever you want, but make sure you say it. For me, for example, I go with the way that we say the Basmala loud. I like that kind of influence by saying it loud. And also, I'm afraid that if I don't do it loud, some people, they will think it's not there. Especially as an imam, I'm reciting the Quran in front of the musallin. So I say it to teach them that, hey, this is part of Surah Al-Fatiha, you say it. And sometimes you hear people, they don't even show you that they are saying it, even silently. I think because of the kind of rushing and they want to just finish. So I think to make sure that you are doing it right, say it loud, no big deal. It's also narrated that the Prophet, peace be upon him, sometimes he used to say it loud and sometimes he used to say it silently. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you remember in Surah Al-Hijr, verse number 87, he described Surah Al-Fatiha that it's 7 verses by saying, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي والقرآن العظيم. So Allah describes Surah Al-Fatiha that it is 7 verses. That's why Surah Al-Fatiha started with verse number 1, which is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now, what is the meaning of Mathani? For sure, this ayah talking about Surah Al-Fatiha. Mathani in Arabic, when you repeat, do it more and more and more. You repeat it more and more and more. This is al-mathani. Yuthanna, 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 yuthanna. That's why we recite Surah Al-Fatiha a lot of times. Imagine in each salah, we recite Surah Al-Fatiha in each rak'ah. If you count how many rak'ah you pray daily and nightly, you will end up reciting Surah Al-Fatiha more than 30 times. That's why Allah describes Surah Al-Fatiha by Al-Mathani. Now, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it's in its place, and it's, subhanAllah, fit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who sent this revelation, this wahi, to the humanity, to this universe. And subhanAllah, the first revelation came. That's how you have the match between the first surah in the Mus'haf started with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, means by the name of God, the most merciful, the most kind. If you go back to the first revelation came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, in the cave, it was Iqra, Bismi Rabbik, read by the name of your Lord. So the first revelation was read by the name of your Lord, and here in the Mus'haf, he is telling you by the name of your Lord. You see how the matching? Very beautiful. There is harmony, and this harmony will stay with us from page number 1 to page 604 in the Quran. It's very beautiful, a wonderful harmony and matching, and subhanAllah, in a way that no way a hand of a man or any other power touch or has any influence over this book. Absolutely. By His name, all the beginnings. And by His name, all the finals. And by His name, all the movement in this universe. Nothing will be, or nothing will move, or nothing will be created. Nothing will be growing. Nothing will be exist without His permission and without His absolutely name. And when I say by the name of God, means by His willing, by His command, by His order. As what we use here in our life, by the name of the president, I give you this kind of command. He has the authority to give you this order because he has that kind of power. And the same thing, and we say always, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثُلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah is above all the examples, subhanahu wa ta'ala. By His name, everything will be, and without His name, without His permission, nothing will be. Bismillah. Now, what is the meaning of Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim? Absolutely. When I say, by the name of God, the most merciful, the most kind, I conclude all the types of mercy and all the shapes of mercy. He is the most merciful to us. He is the most merciful to the community, to the creations around us. Wherever you look, you see the mercy in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is something special, something private for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by giving him this title. He is Ar-Rahman. That's why the name Ar-Rahman and the name Allah, it's just for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for God, for the Creator. I can't call any person Rahman. I can't call any person that he is Ar-Rahman. We should dedicate that kind of sifat and asma, or that kind of names, just to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why, ikhwani, al-basmala itself, it will give you the vision of the Islamic point of view about life and about the hereafter and about the universe, just by Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. After you say Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, you say Alhamdu Lillah. Absolutely. Praise and thanks due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the beginning, and due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the end and in between. that this is very solid rule and very solid connection between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if there is somebody deserved to be thanks, he is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why he started with Alhamdu lillah, not for any other power. If there is hamd, absolutely it's for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to thank him. If you want to praise him. He is the one and he is the only one. We have a riwayah, a narration that a Muslim, he said, O Lord, thanks due to you as you deserve. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the angels to write that kind of dua until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will meet him in the day of judgment and he will reward him. The angels couldn't measure that kind of good deeds and how much he deserved a good deeds based on what he said, that dua. Ya Rabbi, laka alhamdu, kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa azimi sultanik. O my Lord, alhamd due to you as you deserve, as the creator, as the one who has the ultimate power on everything. I praise you, I thank you, Allah. The angels couldn't measure and calculate how much ajr this kind of dua deserved. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, don't worry, put it as is, and I will give him the reward in the day of judgment. That's why, ikhwani, try to make it as a habit every single day. Say this dua, Ya Rabbi laka alhamd, kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa azimi sultanik. Ya Rabbi laka alhamd, kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa azimi sultanik. Ya Rabbi laka alhamd, alhamdulillah. Always return and refer everything to him, not to you, not to your knowledge, not to your money, not to your experience, not to you, to anything else except him and him only. This is very, very important. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. He is the Lord of everything. And this is also another rule in Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha draws the rules, the major foundation of our religion. Bismillah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah. Now, Rabb Al-Alameen. He is the Lord. He is the Lord. He is the owner. And if he is the owner, means he has the authority to do. He is the master. And if he is the owner and the master, he is the one who's taking care. If something got wrong, he will fix it immediately. As the landlord, he is taking care. And nothing will be wrong according to his wisdom and his knowledge, because he is perfect. That's why the sun, the moon, the mountain, the sky, the earth, the oceans, the seas, the trees, everything around us is very accurate. Very accurate. We do mistakes if we rely on ourselves, but the universe, very accurate and has wisdom behind everything. Allah knows that kind of wisdoms. Subhanallah. So this is the meaning of Rabbil Alameen. He is the Lord. He is the owner. He is the master. He is the one who's taking care, and he is the one who runs this universe. He runs the universe. So why I say Alhamdulillah, this is the response to his mercy. Look, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. He is Rahman Rahim from his side toward me. From my side toward him, Alhamdulillah. Why you say Alhamdulillah? Because he is Rahman Rahim. Yes, this is the normal and the logic response from my side to him because of his mercy. If somebody is, subhanAllah, good for you, you return it to him what? Good, absolutely. You do that with the humans. Why you don't do that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You got it? This is the meaning of Alhamdulillah, and why we say Alhamdu, and why we should keep saying Alhamdulillahi Rabb al-Alameen. Then we say Maliki Yawmiddin, another rule of the foundation of this religion. He is the Malik, the controller He is the owner, he is the master of the Day of Judgment, as well he is the master of this life. And if he is the Malik or the Malik, you know, the highest level of authority and controlling, if you are the owner, this is the highest authority. The owner has the authority to do and to and not to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, always we say, لَهُ الْمَثَلْ الْأَعْلَى. He is above all the examples. But this is what it means. Malik, he is the owner, he is the master. And he has the ultimate level of controlling and absolutely maintaining and do whatever he wish, because he is Maliki يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. Then we say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. This is by itself another rule of the foundation of this religion. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ means we worship you only, not anybody else. There is no ibadah except for you. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ, not anybody else. No ibadah except for you. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ. And it's absolutely different than نَعْبُدُ إِيَّاك. If I say نَعْبُدُ إِيَّاك means I could worship somebody else. But إِيَّاكَ only نَعْبُدْ means no ibadah except for you, O my Lord. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. I have no room to request any isti'ana, any help, except from you. You know, nasta'in means to request, to demand the help and the solution and absolutely the support. It should be for nobody except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah, He has His own way to send somebody to help you. But the request should be to Allah and from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is absolutely has a lot of details. We will go over them inshallah in the future. So, إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. Let's go back. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الرحمن الرحيم. مالك يوم الدين. إياك نعبد. إياك نستعين. So this is the half of the surah, or the beginning of the surah, that you create, you draw now the foundation. If this is the reality, okay, come and request from him. Ask him, make dua for him. And this is the practice. How you practice what you believed, how you use this kind of knowledge and relation with him, absolutely by raising your hand and make dua. That's why this is what we do after we say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. What you want from me, O my worshippers? إِهْدِنَا يَا رَبَّنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Guide us and keep us. This is the meaning of this part of the surah. إِهْدِنَا means guide us to the straight and right and wide and clear way to you, and keep us on this path. Because I might start, but then down to the road, I might what? Change. I want your help, O my Lord, to keep me in this straight path to Ya Rabbil Alameen. I know what's haram, what's halal. I know what's haqq and what's batil. I know what's wrong and what's right. I know what is haram and what is halal. Now I need you to help me to stay all my life applying what I knew in the past. I need your help. I need your support. I need your hidayah. That's why, Ikhwani, as Muslims, we say this statement, this request, this demand, every single day, 30 times. When you pray to Allah and you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, O my Lord, guide me. Ihdini. Ihdina. Ihdini means for yourself. Ihdina means for the community. And you are part of the community. إِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. So I need to know, then I need to stay. And I need to stay to the end of my life. We ask Allah to guide us and to keep us on the right path with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is a very beautiful statement to Umar ibn Mad'un. Umar ibn al-Khattab said to Qudama ibn Mad'un, if you fear Allah, you will avoid what he prohibited. There is like a math statement, input and output. Do you fear Allah? Yes, I fear Allah. Means you have to avoid what Allah said, don't do it. You have to avoid what Allah prohibited on you, what Allah commanded you not to do it. So, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. I need Ya Rabbi to guide me to the way that you guided the Prophet, peace be upon him, before me and the companions. I don't want to go to different way, different group, different type of path, the same path. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, because we are part of the community, part of the ummah, and we continue their mission, and our kids will continue our mission, and that's it, etc. Everybody will deliver to the next generation, and this is our amana, and it will be their amana to the future. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين, not those that you had your غضب upon them, you were mad upon them because they did not listen and they change the fact of the revelation, or those that they went astray from the right path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they, by previous intention, they put in their mind the intention not to listen just because their desires went away from the right path and the right way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the meaning of those two verses, not just the previous nations, any group of nations, any group of people, any human being, any person, if he will do the same, he will be part of those verses. Allah will be mad from him, and they will be astray and far away from the right path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will find Muslims also, Allah is not happy from them. We will see Christian, Jewish, and the rest of the religions. It's all about what you are doing in your life regarding your faith and how you respond to the call of the Lord and how you understand and how you follow the fact that you believe it's fact. And absolutely, as I said in the previous episode, if there is book to God, the book should speak about itself by itself. We will stop inshallah today up to here, and we will continue inshallah in the next episode. May Allah bless you all. Jazakumullah khair. Please make dua. See you inshallah very soon. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.